Cheryl has been attending the ladies' Bible study, and she's going to share a little later about that. So thank you very much.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It's been what a spontaneous morning. You guys are a spontaneous bunch. Did you know that? Things are organized. I got to church. Thanks so much for that worship meeting. That was fantastic. Welcome back to my Pentecostal days. That's very great, Pastor. Where to go? I was a drummer like centuries ago, but I wouldn't want to step up and treat that. So remember, Oscar. All right, my story, or our story in 5 minutes. Here we go. Cheryl and I met in Saskatoon. My friend from youth said he had a cousin I should meet. Turned out to be a good match. It worked out. We were married young, 19 and 20. Cheryl was just 20, just 6 days after her 20th birthday, so pretty young. We had a lot to learn. One of us had more to learn than the other. About a year after that, I got a job with the province as a conservation officer. And for the next 16 years, we moved 11 times and lived in six small towns. So during those years, our routine was to find a church of Christ followers and get involved. We attended many evangelical, I wrote denoms for denominations, and when I read it this morning, demons. Denominations. Many different denominations. We volunteered in program and leadership, so we've likely been involved in every role in ministry over the years, like seriously, everything. We're pretty old. Church was a replacement for our families being so far away. It was a great switch for us. And you know what? You move to a new community, you find a church. We found one within a couple weeks. We felt like, okay, we're settled. It's better. You know, and it was wonderful. We were in the Regina area 24 years, and our lives were very blessed there. Good jobs. Cheryl was a teacher, university instructor, and I was a senior program director with the government of Saskatchewan. Many good relationships that were both encouraging and discipling. We have two wonderful kids, a 34-year-old son who's in Regina, and a 37-year-old daughter. As I approached 35 years with the province of Saskatchewan, we had been having serious conversations with dear friends who were missions directors in the Latin America and Caribbean region for the Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada, which is my home church, about doing volunteer missions work. After some serious listening and discerning, we decided it was time for me to stop working and become self-supporting global volunteers. With Cheryl working part-time, she could take off a semester to travel. I was 55 years old when I stopped working for a paycheck. If you think that's easy to do, talk to me about that. 35 years, I got a check every month, and then they stopped, and I was responsible from then on. So that was not an easy decision by any measure. Our journey as followers of Christ became about being willing to say yes to opportunities and then taking the first step in the journey. With each step, the path gets a little bit more revealed. Not the whole thing, just part of it. So more about saying yes and being obedient with open hands to receive blessing than with the closed hands. I'm ready, God. What do you want me to do? I think I can fit it in. Maybe just stick it under my armpit. Sometimes we feel like that, but we say, this is how we want to be. Open our hands and make ourselves available. That's not easy. As global volunteers, I'm part of the regional leadership team, and we have deployed a number of times in the region since 2015. Usually for 2 or 3 months at a time, but also for shorter periods. Cheryl brings English as a second language teaching and curriculum development expertise, and I bring organizational consulting, strategy, and HR policy. We both have done myriad other tasks. My first job when I got to Honduras in 2015 was to build a woodshed out of scrap lumber. No problem. Do that. So we've both done a lot of things, but our task and our desire is to come alongside the full-time global workers and be helpers and encouragers. We have been so blessed and inspired by our colleagues, and it's so good to see the testimonies and faithfulness of God and the necessity for the Canadian churches to partner with our global workers as they partner with local churches, pastors, and communities. The transformational changes through the amazing obedience and dedication of the ministry teams have changed our view of our faith and how we, as part of, and you, as part of the world's top 1% financially. Did you know that? Everyone in this room, unless you have zero money, you're in the top 1% of the world. Think about that for a moment. So how can we financially contribute in some sort of lasting impact? There's more to this story, but that's another time over a meal. We have moved here to Caremese as a partnership with our daughter and son-in-law and two grandchildren, who we hope will be joining us sometime in later 2023. They plan to get into the wine industry, whatever that looks like. So since last fall and for the next year, we'll be building. We feel very blessed to be here with you and look forward to getting to know you and to serve together. Cheryl. Cheryl has already shared her story with the ladies group, but she's going to share a little bit more. Left you 2 minutes.
Oh, I don't need 2 minutes. Like I shared my story, as Rick said already, with the ladies, some of it. But Dwayne asked if I would just take a moment to share my perspective on the Tuesday morning ladies' table talk that I've been attending and enjoying from the second week that we arrived here in Caremias last fall. And it's a wonderful group. So this is my encouragement for all of you who can get away at all on Tuesday mornings. I've observed a welcoming, brave, and safe space for women to share. And with all the churches that we've been part of, I'm sorry to say, you know, that's not that easy to find. There's still a lot of people that put on a face when they go to a group or a club or church. But in this group, I've observed that the women are from many different ages, different ethnicities, different backgrounds, all kinds of different experiences, and no one is putting on a good face. They're comfortable sharing their authentic selves. Caremias reminds us in that way of one other place that we lived. Rick did mention LaRange, Saskatchewan, way up north, northern communities, another small town like this in a rural area where most people weren't concerned about appearances and status and keeping up with the Joneses or whatever. Everyone was accepted because they were probably only going to be there for a short time, make friends quickly, and enjoy life there. And I don't think Caremias is quite so transient, but it seems to me, from our experience, especially in this church, that it is a place where people are welcomed and can be themselves. This is so important in the times in which we live, when the world is saying, or the world is demanding, diversity, inclusion, equity, and falsely assuming that that's not to be found in the church. We need to demonstrate that. I'm going to share a little passage with you from Jesus' last words, his last prayer for his disciples before he left on Passover. He said, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message." And that's us, right? All of us believe in him through the message of the disciples. "That all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." And what I see in our ladies' group is unity amid diversity, which is in short supply. But it's a major marker of those who are Christ followers. And I've seen Georgina and the other leadership of the ladies' group promoting the values that Jesus prioritized by encouraging different women to share their stories, make themselves vulnerable, and then find love, acceptance, and unity in their sisters together on this journey to become more like Jesus. And the ladies group is looking forward with anticipation to seeing what God has in store for this community through the ladies of this church, through the youth of this church, I heard earlier this morning, and also through the ladies group. So I guess the men, time for the men to step up as well.
Thank you very much. several hard acts to follow all morning long. We will try our best. We will do our best. We always do. So grateful for so much. I really am so grateful for so much. Before I begin my thoughts for this morning, I just want to comment briefly on last week. You know, whenever I speak, whenever I listen to someone speak, and some are certainly better at it than others, if you want to have a good message, you know, you don't need to come here. You just go on YouTube and you can listen to the best in the world. And there are people out there who are very gifted communicators. And my efforts, I should comment on the YouTube thing. No, I won't. So my efforts here, I think of when our boys were little and they would draw a picture or whatever and they would bring it to us and they'd want us to put it up on the fridge, and the leading question was, so what is that? And, oh, lovely, it looks just like one of those. So when I consider my efforts at speaking, I think that that's my endeavor to bring my picture to God, and he puts that up on his fridge, and sometimes he says, so what is that? And, oh, that's what that was. So last week, what sometimes you hear from when someone speaks is not necessarily what they believe. That's just their best efforts to paint a picture. And I conclude my message with the last few verses of 1 Corinthians 14. And Georgina drew this to my attention that I may have communicated something, and certainly I may have. So if you recall, some were given to be apostles, prophets, teachers, and gifts of healing. And the leading thought in that verse is that do all, you know, have these gifts? And the obvious answer is no, but then there's a flip side to that, and some do have that gift. And in no way do I believe that anyone can be an apostle or a prophet or an apostle, and nor does everyone have a gift of healing. But by the same token, I believe that everyone in the body of Christ can have a flavor of any one of these giftings. Absolutely. If we don't carry a flavor of all the gifts that are represented and designated in the New Testament, something's wrong if we don't carry a flavor. But there are people who stand in and walk and function in the office of these ministries. So that's my concluding thought on that. If I did communicate something, and I didn't hear that anyone picked up on that, but I say that because it was drawn to my attention that perhaps I did miscommunicate. Hallelujah. So bless the Lord. Hallelujah. 11 o'clock. Lunch isn't until 12 or 1 anyway, so not a problem. We've had a good morning, and I appreciate everything and everyone. Thank you, Rick and Cheryl. And welcome to our family. And I've always appreciated about us, and you kind of highlighted that, drew attention to it, that what I appreciate about us as a church family is that we walk real close to the dirt. There ain't no high and mighties here, and there's no one here who's less than. We are a family that gathers at a common table and enjoys the goodness of God together. Bless God. So this morning, in view of what's happening down in various locations with respect to revival, I want to comment briefly on that and just wander into my message in a deeper way. You know, there's been a revival that's been going on for several years that has received very little attention or acknowledgement. It's gone around the world. It has its apostles, prophets, evangelists, and it's kind of happened in a way that hasn't really caught the attention of most people. It's been a revival of evil, of darkness. It has its apostles, prophets, evangelists, teachers. It's gone around the world. There isn't a progressive country that has not been impacted by this revival. The word revival or awakening, renewal, you can't have a revival or awakening or a renewal unless something has either died or has nearly died.
Amen.
That's why we have a revival, or an awakening, or a renewal. It's really that simple. If we look at Old Testament examples of Israel, they had their cake. At times they ate it as well. But in keeping with human nature, Like they had the world by the tail, Israel, because they served what was known as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There's many gods, but there was this one God that was an amazing God, and he was known as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And these people who knew that God, like, they had the world by the tail. And yet they would fall away, and when they would go into bondage and life was tough, they'd call out to God, and his faithfulness and his love would rescue them. So here we are in an age when the world is changing in a way that we have never seen. The people who are alive today, you and I, our young ones, our old ones, we have never seen what is going on today. There has been such a revival of evil, and it has gone around the world. And guess what? When something dies or is nearly dead, and the people of God cry out and repent, and we are seeing it happen. Something that is very unique about revivals, whether it's an evil one or a good one, is they're very contagious. Very contagious. And that's why this evil has so quickly encompassed the world. And that's why when there's a revival of holiness, that's why it spreads so quickly. It is very contagious, very contagious. The Asbury Revival, in the first 2 weeks of its happening, it attracted 20,000 people to that location. That community is the same size as our community. 6,000 people in that community. People have come from all states, United States, probably Canada too. Various parts of Europe, South America. 20,000 people. Entirely amazing. There's something about it that is very contagious. Very contagious. And not only does it draw people there, then it springs up from there. They supposedly go back to their location, they give a testimony, and it happens. Proof it happens. When I look at what's happening now and what's happened with other revivals, we've talked about this numerous times here, whether it was the Azusa Street Revival, which was one of the more remarkable revivals in unique ways, or whether it's the Toronto Revival happened in our lifetime, the Brownsville Revival, happened in our lifetime. What happened in these revivals, and we could include the Jesus People movement as well, although it didn't have as broad of reach as what these other ones have had. But when I look at these revivals and kind of what's happening now with the Asbury Revival and how that's just spread around, it helps me understand what happened in the first century of Christianity. In Colossians, Paul says there, this gospel has gone around, or has gone to all the world. So in the known world, in Paul's day, which was like probably 50 or 60 years, I didn't study when he wrote Colossians, but it would have been in that era, 50 or 60 years after the death of Christ, this gospel had gone to all parts of the known world. I understand how that can work, because I look at, in 2 weeks, 20,000 people have gone through the community of Asbury. How is it that when you read the first few chapters of the book of Acts, on the first day, 3,000 people get saved?
Yeah.
3,000 stubborn Jews get saved. And then a chapter later, 5,000 more. How is that possible? When I look at what's happening in this revival now, well, it's easily possible. Those are small numbers. And how could it spread around the world? Why would they be motivated to go? It's easily understood. It is. These revivals, or a revival, is very contagious. And when it happens to the magnitude of what we have seen historically, what you and I have seen and witnessed, or what happened in 1906 or 1904 in Wales, it's easy to understand how this is possible, how the gospel in the first century just spread like wildfire. Hallelujah. But here we are in Carameas, and we're small in number today for whatever reason. Bless the Lord. People probably knew Georgina wouldn't be here, so they skipped church. But here we are. This is our community. Is there a remote responsibility that we are responsible for this community? Is there any truth or, like Jesus said, what you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, what you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Many angles, twists on that scripture. Is there any remote possibility that that could apply to us in some way and that we are responsible for our community? And there are certainly other scriptures that aren't as tangly as that one that clearly suggest that we are in partnership with the efforts of heaven. There's a scripture in Isaiah, well, Isaiah 54, it's a lengthy chapter. The beginning of that whole chapter, well into the chapter, is well worth reading, Isaiah 54. But in verse 1, it starts off saying, so if you read that chapter, the beginning of that chapter, it is a very clear picture of God, when he had no children, when Adam and Eve fell, and the world up until, humanity up until the completed work of Christ, God had no children. After Christ, he begins to have children. Single barren woman, God, you who never bore a child. And if you read into this, and I mean further verses, but this verse describes it well. It's more explicit even further on. You who never were in labor, because more are the children of the desolate woman, God, than those who had as a husband, darkness. So this verse tells me, and when I look at revival, this verse tells me that it is possible that there will be more people in heaven than in hell. That there will come a revival that is going to overwhelm darkness. Amen. And when I see what happened within 2 weeks of the Asbury revival, that 20,000 people cycled through there in 2 weeks, or when I read in the book of Acts how the church started, and in a very short time, the world at that time knew about the gospel, I look at those two examples and I read this scripture and I say, easy, 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 hallelujah. But here you and I are in our community. This is where we live. This is where we go to a restaurant. This is where we make our living. Or we did make our living if we're retired. This is where we go to the doctor. This is where we have our home. This is where we come to church. This is where we demonstrate responsibility if we dare assume that position. What kind of a church do we want to be? What kind of a message would we want to hear Sunday morning? Sometimes I pull out one of my old messages. When I'm done, I put it in my Bible. And I've got some old ones here. Eventually, I take them out and I put them in the plot. once in a while I, well, very seldom, I kind of read back and I just see, should I chuck this in or what? And I read it and I think, wow, that was pretty good. Or when Marina spoke several weeks ago, I still see her attached. It was a very good message. And so that leads me to two thoughts. One, do we remember those messages? And secondly, if it was a real home run message where everybody thought, wow, that was pretty good. Yeah, well, he's really catching on. If that's the highlight of the week, or a real good song service, if a good message or a good song service is the highlight of the week for us as a church, something's wrong. Something's wrong. This morning, there was four people up there and one people here. And how many are here? And this happens week after week. If the message or a song service is the only thing we've got to boast about for the week, something, like to me, that's a red flag. That's a red flag. It's a red flag. In Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, in my mind, the focus here is not the apostle, prophet, pastor, teacher, evangelist. The focus here is God's people. God's people. And once again, if the highlight of our week as a church family is the message or a song service, I see a red flag. This is where we live. This is where we eat, sleep. Shop, go to the doctor, go for a walk, go for a hike. What else do we do?
Renovate.
Go to the lumber yard. Bump into people who, it could be a stranger, probably, not necessarily.
Hi.
Well, that's very important. I like introducing myself to things that I hunt, take pictures and stuff, invite them over for dinner, for a meal. We are responsible for this community. And when we go down our pathway, we see people who have needs. They have needs. If they could just get the breadcrumbs from one of our good times here, they would think they had a real amazing. We're responsible for them. We're responsible to tell them about Jesus, to pray for them, to encourage them, to love them, to and demonstrate that love in many ways. Maybe give them some money. Give them a ride. Help them do something at their house. There's just no end to how we could respond to what's out there. There is no end to it all.
Last week we talked about addicts. We talked about addictions. When we raise the word addict, we see it in a very negative light. The word addict, it just simply means a person enthusiastically devoted to a specific thing or activity. If we raise the word addict, we have a negative connotation associated with it. If I said, are there any addicts here this morning? Could I see your hand, please? Whoa, we would just kind of shrink back. I listened this week or a couple of days ago to a testimony of a girl who, she might have been close to 20 when she shared this story. At 12 years old, she was a drug addict. By age 15, she had overdosed 4 times. At age 14, she moved into a drug house. She said it was absolutely horrible to live there. But she said it was a better place than my home. So the word addict is a very kind of a negative thing. Let me read the definition one more time. A person enthusiastically devoted to a specific thing or activity. How many addicts do we have here this morning? Good. Thank you. I've been an addict. This fall, October 23rd, will mark 50 years of me being a hardcore addict. October 23rd, 1973, on a Tuesday night, I got baptized in the Holy Spirit. My life changed. I've been an addict ever since. I've been a hardcore addict ever since. So this young girl, she shared a little bit about her home life, and from the negative side of being an addict, most addicts on that side of things, they come out of a desperate situation. Usually their home life as a child is not good. It is absolutely not good. There's no value there. There's no hope there. There's such an absentee of everything that would require someone to be a success. When we become a believer, we become a part of the family of God. Ephesians 2:19 says that we are members of God's household. In God's household, we are introduced to values and a lifestyle that brings hope and puts us back together. There's definite earmarks of what makes a negative addict, and there are definite earmarks which makes a God follower addict. Yeah. It's in the home. It's in the family. When I became an addict 50 years ago, I valued the house of the Lord. I valued leadership over me, and I listened to their instruction. I valued the Holy Spirit and his influence, his leading, his guiding, his help, his voice. I valued that in my life. I valued prayer. And I don't mean praying at meal time or, God help me, I need a parking spot. Hours of dedicated prayer, seeking God, specifically seeking God. And out of that came a help, a voice, instruction that just hit my strongholds head on, head on. And God would say, you need to deal with this, you need to deal with this. And out of my addiction and my commitment to this program, this rehab program, I became a different person. I became a different person. How many addicts are here? I am a hardcore addict. Hallelujah. And it comes down to this. It comes down to this. If in fact we are responsible for this community, if in fact we are, how are we going to pull this off? How are we going to pull this off? Hallelujah. I know for sure those 20,000 people that have cycled through the Ashbury Revival, those people were hungry for God. I just kind of assumed that. I just kind of assumed that. How are we going to pull this off here? Being hungry for the Lord. And I just know that in this community, there are people who need Jesus. They need Jesus. They may not know that. And that might not be what you would want to say to them. Hey, you just need Jesus. You may not. You probably wouldn't say that. And if you did, I'd probably say you should have said that different. But there are people in this community who we come in contact with probably regularly, who need what we have. And somehow we begin a relationship or a conversation that is non-confrontational, and we present truth. People need Jesus. People need Jesus. Hallelujah. I'd like a song to be played, and then we'll conclude. Thank you, Freddie.
We did everything we could.
Are you past the point of end? Is your burden weighing you down? Is it all too much to carry? Then it's in our souls to change. Do you think I am free? Just losing all the steam. Thank you. tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he takes away where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sin that he can't say. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love's strong and his grace is true. And who's in his arms knows me. And you'll feel when he's gone to lay. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
We never experience revival here in the truest sense of the word like they do in other places. That leaves no excuse that we personally can't be revived and take up responsibility and give the answer to those in need. Not in a preachy way, please don't embarrass me or this church. Please don't do that. But in a very gentle, clever way, share Jesus with them. And when it comes to talking about Jesus, they'll be ready because you did it right. And you're not going to slam the door. You're going to say, tell me more. Tell me more. We have the answer. People need hope. People need love. People need healing. People need a reason to get up in the morning. They need a reason to go to bed with a happy heart and hope. Amen. You be blessed. You have a super week. somebody about Jesus.